Then one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, perceiving that he had answered them well, asked them, "Which is the first commandment of all?" Jesus answered them, "The first of all the commandments is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your mind and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. And the second, like it, is this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these."
And if you love the Lord's day and the Lord's people, this is a treat for you. It's a treat for me to be standing before you as a speaker to guide our thoughts together from the Word of God. Love worshiping. Enjoyed this morning. Thought we had a great day. A lot of positive things came out of that. We'll be mentioning some of those in just a moment. And I anticipate we'll end this day of worship in a great way. We'll see what the Lord has in store for that. A couple of reminders. Nicaragua mission trip deadlines. See Greg Glover by tonight, if you plan on going, if you haven't let him know for sure about that. This coming Sunday night, Josh Cantrell will be giving a report about their recent trip down to Nicaragua, showing some slides about the good work that they were able to accomplish. Look forward to that. I may be introducing a series, kind of a Sunday night series on the seven churches of Asia, Revelation 2 and 3. We'll see about that. We may, Josh and I may kind of split that up, so we'll see about that. It was a joy this morning to witness Alyssa Huggins being born into the family of God. She was baptized by Doyle this morning. We rejoice with Danny and Wendy and her there on the back row. Wonderful addition. Be sure and welcome them tonight. That was after most had filed out. So if you were thinking, "I don't remember that happening," well, that's probably why. Continue to pray for Eric Dixon, Connie, and that family, and his heartfelt response again this morning. We made the announcement that if any of you have or know of someone that may have a rental house available in about a month, an indefinite length of time, young couple moving this way, be working here, would have need of that. So let's network and get word back to me at the church office if that's something that you know about or can help with. Next Sunday, care teams 4 and 5 have a meal together in the fellowship building. Have an Italian theme. One thing they need is for you to be signing up, including tonight, to indicate what you're going to bring. They want a good variety of some things for that. And then Care Group 8, not to be left out, be meeting at TJ and Sarah Spradling. So busy day of eating opportunities, further fellowship this coming Sunday. Keep that in mind. Spring forward, we're losing an hour of sleep, but gaining that hour of daylight starting this coming weekend. That's exciting for a lot of us. Some folks that haven't been able to drive for some time because of darkness at night certainly cannot use that as an excuse. They're really happy about the prospect of that, at least on Sunday nights for the next little while. I realize that's a lot of announcements. I think that maybe is the bulk of them. So let's have our Bibles back open to Mark 12. I actually want you to hold that for just a moment. I want to take you to a different text there. Some of you have a tablet or phone or something, and then maybe it may be quicker for you to go back and forth between these verses than the rest of us. But can I take us to Luke 10? As we think about the greatest commands tonight, this is going to be one of those sections, text very familiar to you, and it's kind of a double thing. And by that, I mean it's familiar, and as this familiar text to us also examines a familiar text back to the Jews in the immediate context here. Familiar texts are familiar for a purpose. They need to be studied carefully. Sometimes we feel like I've learned everything I can about them. I've heard multiple lessons on this, and maybe nothing tonight will be new. Nothing tonight, just earth-shattering for you, but it will be consoling to realize and relish a God who loves so much and who demands so much of us as well. I take you to Luke chapter 10. I want you to look with me in verse 25, where the Bible says, "And behold, a certain lawyer, expert in the Jewish laws," well, how that refers to it, "he stood up and he tested him," Jesus, "saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' very similar, if I could stop just for a moment, to what the rich young ruler said in another context here. Well, Jesus said to him, verse 26, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? Certainly you've got an opinion or an interpretation. So before I answer, let me hear from you. And he answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. Fundamentally, that's Deuteronomy 6, 5 and Leviticus 19, verse 18. So as he's asking about inheriting eternal life, Jesus says, well, we've got a source, we've got a resource, and it's obviously the Bible. It's not man's opinions or things. So as one who is an expert in the Jewish law, what has stood out to you? And he mentions and quotes these two passages. Now, if Jesus had thought that this was a subpar answer, that it was somehow insufficient or lacking in some way, I think he, in his great wisdom, would have called him on it. But actually what we find in verse 28 is Jesus commending him and saying, you have answered rightly, do this and you will live. Now notice Jesus says, do this, not just think this. It's not enough to merely teach this. You need to do what these passages demand of you personally. It's one thing to have it intellectually, but are you willing to love God with all that you are? To love Him supremely in that way? That's asking a lot, isn't it? Well, obviously it is. And so he wanting to justify himself, this lawyer, verse 29, asked Jesus, who is my neighbor? His hang-up didn't seem to be in the first part of that, the Deuteronomy 6, 5, but Jesus, I want to know who my neighbor is. If I'm supposed to love him as myself, as Moses taught Leviticus 19, 18, wouldn't it be important that we get that definition? And Jesus used that as an opportunity, a springboard to teach what we call the parable of the Good Samaritan. I think you've heard of it before. And so what is interesting is this very same text, and the account that was read, at least the first part in Mark 12, is not a parallel account. This isn't just another rendering of it. This comes a little bit later, not that long, within, say, a couple of years. This is, in Mark 12, going to be the day of questions, very likely Tuesday, the last Tuesday of Jesus' earthly life here. And different ones, Pharisees, Sadducees, have asked him about things. They talked about the resurrection, and they're going to be talking about David's son, who he is, and all that. And so with these different ways of, for maybe nearly a final time, putting Jesus on the hot seat, trying to discredit him or maybe make him look silly, at least that's the motivation of some of them, Jesus is going to be on the aggressive. He's going to be on the offensive in considering this passage here. You'll see what we mean by that in just a moment. So there in Mark chapter 12, let's revisit it here. One is said, before we get into verse 28 once more, that essentially to love God is to love Him for all that He is, all those things He's revealed about His nature, about His character, and to love Him with all that you are. The very things that God has given us, the four dimensions that Jesus mentions in the text, are the ways in which we are to respond, not to reciprocate in the idea, I will love God with the same fervency, the very same energy that He's extending to me, but no, I will return it to Him. And I'm going to love Him for as long as He gives me to do that. For as long as I'm here in this earth, short or long, somewhere in the middle, doesn't matter. And I'm going to do that for eternity because of His great gift to me. Isn't it great to know that there is not a sinner whom God does not love? Everyone is under the umbrella of that familiar John 3:16. They're part of that world that Jesus, talking to Nicodemus, says God loved the world so much that He gave His only begotten Son. Love is such an important doctrine. It is a very involved concept. No wonder that Jesus talked about it a lot. You know, all the way back in Matthew 5, Jesus had already, in the early part of his ministry, and what is some called His inaugural address, said that we are to love our enemies. You've heard that it was said, hate them, but no, love them. That was pretty revolutionary, wasn't it? Here he's going to talk about love, and he's going to talk about it as an essential, as a foundational, very fundamental prospect here. If I look back at Mark 12, verse 28, I want to notice something about one of the scribes. Who were the scribes? Greek literally is the learned ones. Matthew's account, and there is a parallel there in Matthew chapter 22, is going to be a lawyer, and specifically of the Pharisees. They would love to debate all types of things. There are people that love debate, not necessarily of a controversial nature, but if you take one position, they'll come out with another, and there's this what if, and hey, and they like to spar verbally and kind of cognitively. They like to not necessarily show their prowess in their observational skills, but they just like to talk about things. Oh, the lawyers, if you enjoy that, you would have fit in so well with them. And there were the ones that kind of were the cream of the crop. They were the ones who had elevated themselves or been elevated in the minds of their fellows. And so what they said really gained traction. It was important. They would talk about their perspectives or their different views on these matters. And so not at all unusual to that day and time, that way of thinking there. The scribe heard them reasoning together. He'd been listening, overhearing the previous sparring that had taken place in this chapter. And finally, it's his turn. And so he perceived that he had answered them well. He perceived that Jesus was right. It's a wonderful thing if I look at the words of Jesus and I say, that's amazing. That is wisdom. There is authority right there. So here's a man, not that his estimation of Jesus made Jesus greater, but who was right on track. He looked at Jesus and he listened to that and said, you know what, that's probably even head and shoulders above other teachers, other humans that I've taught here. He's got a question of his own. Evidently, he was not there on that occasion in Luke 10 where Jesus and another scribe, one of the learned teachers of the law had discussed this with Jesus. And he asked Jesus, look at it in verse 28, which is the first commandment of all? Did he mean the very first one given? I suggest to you that's not what he meant. He's talking about the foremost, the most important. Is there one actually that maybe supersedes, overrides, is higher in its content or its lofty ideals than the others? And I don't think he was expecting Jesus to say yes or no. If Jesus had said yes, then obviously, well, what is it? It's not enough just to know that there's one that's greater, but which is the first commandment of all? And so Jesus, number one, is going to give an inclusive answer in verse 29. Here it is. The first, the foremost of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. That is the Jewish Shema, taken from the word hear. Very first word in that, the hear. The Jews, we're told in that day, would begin their morning reading this passage. Some of them, for good measure, would end the day with the very same one. I mean, they knew it backwards and forwards. They could say it in their sleep. This was the premier text, if there was one that maybe was the most familiar to them. Isn't it interesting that Jesus says the foremost one is that one? It's the one that you've been reading. And because you know it so well, does that mean that you're living it out perfectly? Imagine if you could transport yourself back in time to Moses' generation, hearing Deuteronomy, that second telling of the law based on Exodus 20, and to realize that, okay, if Israel collectively had gotten that one right, the Lord is one, there would have been no idolatry. There would have been no judgments against them for that sin. And yet that's the besetting sin. That's the one that keeps rearing its ugly head generation after generation, isn't it? So it was one thing to know that that's the way it ought to be and that's important, but it didn't really reflect itself in their actions, did it? If they were to love the Lord supremely, Deuteronomy 10:12 is kind of the essence of what you see in verse 30. We'll get to that in a moment. There would not have been any of the immorality problems. There would not have been many of the things that caused a whole generation to die in the wilderness before they inherited the promised land. So I wonder if Jesus is actually saying, you know what? It's one thing to know it. Not just how did they do back then, but how am I doing now with that? Am I one that values by my actions that God really is the best? And thinking about that being an inclusive answer, we use that word inclusive in a way today. Sometimes I shake my head and I hear people using inclusive to mean include everybody. That's not a bad thing. God's an inclusive God in the sense that he loves everyone. He wants everyone, obviously, universally, to be blessed. Not everyone's going to do that. Sometimes as we use it, it's the idea of including things that sometimes contrary to the will of God, to be looked upon and accepted on an equal par with things that are not. And so we need to be careful how we use the word, but inclusive itself is not a bad word at all. Jesus is saying this applies to everyone. Now, Jesus is a Jew, living as a Jew for now, but he's come for a different purpose. He's not just the latest in a long line of respected rabbis. It's not just a reformation of an existing religion. We understand that. He's come for a higher purpose. He's going to initiate the kingdom, the church. That is the final dispensation of which we're a part now. And so this is going to be very fundamental, very important for those of us still living in that last dispensation to grasp and lay hold of, to try to apply our minds to. It's an instructive answer. I want you to see verse 30. Simple words, no hard concepts. The difficulty merely lies in the application, doing what is very demanding of us. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first. It's the foremost commandment. Heart, soul, mind, and strength. And that word love is that word we get a form of agape there. This is a future indicative. It is love him, not just one time, not just now. Love him and keep on loving him. And keep on living up to the great challenge that's involved in that. The Lord your God. Do it with your heart. The heart, as the Jews thought of it, was the seat of emotions, the affections, the passions. I am to love God supremely that way. And then the soul. What does he mean by the soul? Soul is generally thought of as the personality even and the spirit within us. The mind, our thoughts, and our intelligence. It is okay. In fact, it is fundamental to love God with the mind. In other words, if I don't know who God is, if I won't even apply my mind to study what this revealed will is, doesn't matter if I love him in the other ways. It's kind of a subpar, a substandard love. It's not just an emotional love, not an ooey-gooey sentimental love at all. It's an informed love. And notice again, it's not one, pick one of these four. Pick a couple, do three if you want to. No, it's all of these in a perfect blending here. Love him with your mind and love him with your heart. Love him with your strength is the last of the four there. You know what, as I think about the strength, I'm giving motion to my emotion. I am not just content with the intellect, I'm adding industry to that. I think Jesus is trying to look at what an average human, in fact, every human, our makeup, what we are, what God has given us, and says, give that all back to God. Let God challenge you intellectually. Let your emotions, your feelings, this strength that you have, all of these be marshaled together in a kind of a unified front and showing that love and that respect back to God. This is the first commandment. As with many things, it's easier to give the right answer than to do the right thing. If our young folks were to ask in a Bible class or a Bible bowl question, what's the first commandment? It's easy to spout that out. It doesn't take long to do it at all. And Jesus wasn't wanting to give brownie points just to the ones that had the right answers, was he? Now, it is important. I am not downplaying the knowledge and how important this is in knowing, but Jesus said, do it. Do it. Don't be content with just the intellectual here. This must be applied. You can have a high price prescription given you by a doctor, and it's amazing. It's not a miracle drug, but close to it. As long as it stays in the bottle on the shelf, it is not doing you any good. I don't care if it was given to you free or if you had to sell a car to buy it. Just because it's been prescribed doesn't mean it's effective. It's got to be applied and taken in to have any effect at all there. For a lot of us, I guess the gap is in our profession and our practice. One thing to say, I love the Lord. He's been so good to me. Harder to show him what I'm doing there. You've heard a story, and I'll give this as an example, of a woman who was married to a very harsh, very cruel, unloving husband. He used to write out a list for her every day of things that he wanted her to do. Demands, really, not suggestions. Sweep the floor, clean the bathrooms, and all this stuff. A little bit different list every day. And she loved him, but it wasn't easy to love him. And so she would comply with those, not joyously. In fact, she dreaded to see what the list was going to be each day. This man died in time, and she had some relief, actually, when he was gone. And she met a man that she loved and was good to her, that loved her in a healthy way. And he didn't give demands to her. He didn't give a list like the former husband. But she noticed that every day that she was dutifully doing many of the things, the sweeping and the cleaning and the cooking, and doing it very cheerfully. She woke up each morning not dreading the days and its activities, but wanting to get into those because she knew it pleased him. And so the difference was in the attitude. God is not a harsh, dictatorial tyrant who is given commands in the Bible. These 248 positive in the Old Testament, the 365 negative. The scribes could have told you, yep, that tallies up to 613. We respect them so much, and yet they really didn't go by them that much. Looking for ways around them, out of them, trying to codify them, change them ever so slightly into ways that ended up sometimes getting away from the original intent of that law. But the idea is, do we look at God as one who loves us? And our loving response back to him is not an indication he doesn't care, not an indication somehow that he's more demanding than he should be, but it's fair and fitting. And our gratitude changes our attitude toward this one that we love so much. When Jesus gave that answer, I wonder if it was pretty silent there in the temple precinct. People are just kind of thinking, mulling it over, wondering maybe what they would have said or how they could get back at the answer that he gave. Jesus didn't give them long to think, because in verse 31, he's going to say, and the second. I give you number one, here's number two. You didn't ask for two. Maybe the scribes thought we were talking about the foremost. Jesus said the second is like it. The second is like the first. What do you mean it's like it? Well, both of them have love as their basis. In another way, they have an object outside of yourself as the one that you're loving. They both are important, obviously. You can't say, well, I'll take one but not two, or two but not one. No, it's like it. It's this from Leviticus 19:18. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There's no other commandment greater than these, Jesus said. Now, he didn't say commandments even. This version of this translation, if it's right, is a commandment singular. He's thinking about the two as if they are one. These are the love commands. It's the command singularly that Jesus is referencing there. Let me give you, in addition to Leviticus 19:18, that, as I've said before, if you were reading over that, this tedious reading as we often think of it in Leviticus 19 wouldn't really jump out of the page at you, wouldn't just slap you in the face and say, hey, look at me, I'm the second most important. I am on a par with the one that Jesus said is going to be the most important. That same chapter down in verse 34, Leviticus 19, the stranger who dwells among you shall be to you as one born among you, and you shall love him as yourself. For you were strangers in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. The stranger. love fellow Jews, yes, love strangers, those who would be the tagalongs in this context here, the ones who would be proselytes, converts to the Egyptians. You love him as you love yourself. That's a high love, isn't it? In Romans 13, 8 through 10, Jesus will be referenced there by Paul as he writes, "Owe no one anything except to love one another, for he who loves another has fulfilled the law." And then Paul says the commandments, including you shall not commit adultery, not murder, steal, bear false witness, covet, or if there is any other commandment, are all summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Paul said that love does no harm to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law. There was a rabbi by the name of Hillel. I think he was born about 40 BC, died about 10 AD. So he and Jesus crossed paths just barely there. Jesus would have been a boy. But Hillel and his teaching and his influence survived up into Jesus' time. He had one of those, if it's the same one, great controversial posts or thoughts about divorce and what was meant back in the law there. But Hillel said, kind of in the negative application of this, whatever you hate, don't do that to others, to your fellow man. Don't do what you hate. And yet, as you think about the law, it's much more positive than that. That's okay. I don't like this. I'm not going to do it to you. But what do you like? What is beneficial to you? It's more challenging for me to do as the Bible and as Jesus is quoting here, referencing the true positive, the looking for others, the taking the initiative to apply that in action there, isn't it? Galatians 5, 13 and 14 is another text where we are encouraged to do this through love, serve one another. And Paul said again, the whole law, all of that is summed up in this, kind of on the horizontal plane, love your neighbor as yourself. When Jesus gave that commandment, when he is there in Mark 12, and you look at the Matthew account there, there's no commandment greater than these. In fact, all the others hinge on. They are kind of under the umbrella of one of those two. By the way, have you heard? It referenced that in the Ten Commandments, essentially, that is 1 through 4 and 5 through 10. That's about it there. These represent our duty to God and our duty to others, those positive and negative things we're either doing or are failing to do there. It's an impressive answer as we look in verses 32 and 34. The scribe said to him, "Well said, teacher." Brag on Jesus. Everything he said was not just well, not merely good, it was better than that. It's the best, it's the most. He says, you've spoken the truth. And I think back to how, well, Jesus couldn't do anything other than speak the truth. He was the way and the truth and the life. So yeah, Jesus spoke truth. There is one God. Little did he probably know at that time, he's looking at the face of God in the flesh. Jesus, did you know there's one God? Yes. I was there in creation with God the Father and with the Holy Spirit, and there is no other but He. Jesus says, I've been hammering that for 3.5 years now. To love Him with all the heart, with all the understanding, with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is more than all the whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. I love that. Jesus, here's what you've said. Now, here's my commentary on it. Here's what I think. Jesus, I get it. Was this scribe, was he against animal sacrifices? I doubt it. I think he kind of understood Hosea chapter 6, verse 6, that the knowledge of God is more important than those things. As you see what Jesus said, not downplaying that, but kind of that sentiment in 1 Samuel about Saul. To obey is better than to sacrifice, to hearken than the fat of rams. If I can know these things, and if I'm attempting to do these things, that's where I need to be. And Jesus said something. Let's think about that. He said, you are not far from the kingdom of God. Not far from the kingdom of God. What do you mean by that, Jesus? in that this man is answering sincerely? Is it because he has a perception of Scripture that maybe is above some of his rivals there? Is it a sensible answer? Well, it is. Is it because he's showing a softness of heart that maybe some of the others weren't keying on? I don't know. For us tonight, it's not enough to be close to the kingdom of God. He said you're not far. He didn't say you're in the kingdom. That kingdom hadn't quite yet been instituted, of course. But you're not far from it. Tonight, it's not enough to be close. We need to be in that kingdom. We need to realize that what Jesus said was right. A lot of our moderns think it's crazy to love someone other or more than yourself. They really don't believe in God, so they don't think that God is to be loved because he's not there to begin with. And so what Jesus said is fundamental. It's what I need to hear, what I need to be reminded of. We will all be before his judgment bar someday, and we will answer for that. I don't want to be among the class that Jesus referred to in John 5, verse 42. I know you, that you don't have the love of God in you. He's not talking about God on his end not loving them. They did not have a love for God. I know you. Do you love God? If you love me, keep my commandments. Which commandments? If my concern is, what are the bare minimum? What's the least I can do and still be part of the kingdom? That thinking is foreign. That is wholly against what I know to be the devotion God's given to me. And so all the commandments. Why? Because they're for my good. They show my love, my proper response toward God. They're going to bless me, not just here, but hereafter. Are you close to the kingdom of God? Notice in verse 34 as we close, after that, no one dared question him. Didn't have any comebacks. Nothing to add to that. Sometimes it's okay to be quiet and you just soak it in, let it sink in, what that really is getting at. A song has been selected tonight. All of us, I can't dictate to you what you do with God. I can't make you love him. I'm trying to make me love him more, not make in the sense of a duty, but a natural response. But some of you that love God more than you ever have are ready to step out in that belief and confess Jesus as the Son of God, to repent of your sins, to be immersed, to have your sins washed away. At that moment, you will show a great depth of commitment to that God. And then you're in the beginning stage. You're taking the baby steps of that relationship in which God's going to be with you. You'll grow in your love to God. He will love and bless you in response to your response to his gracious offer. Tonight, if you're ready to do that, we'd be glad to witness, to encourage you in doing that. While together we stand and sing this song.
Peace.
Exciting day. Sam Kendall has been studying, talking with parents about baptism. He is a young man. He has made a decision that he feels like is an educated decision, one that obviously involves his heart, and that is to become a New Testament Christian. So we're excited about that. His father, Stephen, has the privilege, the honor of baptizing him into Christ. So isn't that great? We're going to have some songs here in between. I don't know if Doyle's got announcements or when we're going to do those, but I think it'd be great, instead of us way back here, great gulf fixed between, let's all take a moment and come up here closer. Very good.
Sam, I have to ask you a very important question. Do you believe with all your heart that Jesus Christ is the Son of the true and living God?
Yes, sir.
I know you do. And upon that confession, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit for the remission of your sins.
Been working okay. I think Dole's got announcements, but he's tied up back there. So I think the only other two things to add are the thank yous we have from the Duncan family and from Carol Smith. So those are posted, will be posted on our board down there. What a great day! We're going to rejoice with this family in just a moment. Let's go ahead and have that closing song. The ones that want to take the Lord's Supper, go back there to the chapel. And who's got our closing prayer? Whoever you are, I'm sure. All right, Doug. They coming out now? All right. Let's go ahead and sing that song. Oh, Ron, singing tonight? Okay, so they're in their spots already, so stay after that. So, all right, our closing song.
Let's pray. Dear Father of all heavenly hosts, who so graciously prepared the earth for mankind, and through your beloved Son has set a way for us to approach you and someday be with you forever. Just as Sam has taken advantage tonight to claim that salvation. Lord, I pray this evening our prayers and our worship, the things spoke, have been pleasing to you and glorified your name. I ask on behalf of those that are hurting and grieving and maybe even in pain for their uncertainty of their souls, God grant them the strength for their hurt and comfort for their grief and a spirit of understanding for their souls. And Lord, when they realize that you've been there all the time for them, I pray that they give you praise and honor because you never did give up on them. Lord, we praise you tonight. Give us strength and courage to be a people that walk in a manner worthy to please you in all respect and bearing fruit in every good work. And you're glorified before men and lifted up as the one true God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who resurrected from the dead to give us life. that we might faithfully serve with joy unspeakable. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.